but we're not free to roam. So we've got two choices, complain in our rooms, or we'll all change the world while we're on Skype and Zoom.
Song for the people of the Torbay region, and it speaks of Captain Savalette that was hired by the King of France to fish codfish because there was a great demand for codfish on Fridays in France in the 15th century. So the king sent him to South America, and he ended up in Guysborough County in Port Phillip. So, here's to you.
Da ram dam deedle deedle dam deedle dam dam deedle deedle dam. Da ram dam deedle deedle dam deedle dam dam deedle deedle dam. Savalette, Savalette was a vast sea captain on a ship. He was hired by the King of France to fish here in this great land. Da-dum-dum-deedle-deedle-dum, deedle-dum-dum-deedle-deedle-dum. By 1565, he ran a dry cod fishery. From the large amount of fish he caught way down beneath the sea. 42 times he dried his cod on the sugar islands of Port Phillip. In 1607, he met with Champlain upon his final trip. Da-dum-dum-deedle-deedle-dum, deedle-dum-dum-deedle-deedle-dum. Well, the Canadians came from Chesapeake in 1783. They finally made it to Torbay with hopes and many dreams. They hunted, fished, and picked wild berries in order to survive and shape the path for where we're at. Acadians have survived. We'll say it loud because we're proud. Acadians have survived. Da-dum dum deedle dum deedle dum dum deedle dum. Well, Acadians came from Chesapeake in 1783. They all Torbay with hopes and many dreams. They hunted, fished, and picked wild berries in order to survive and shape the past to where we're at. Acadians have survived. We'll say it loud because we're proud. Acadians have survived. Da-dum dum. We were so moved by our history and wanted it to go on. So each year in August we tell our story and sing our anthem song. Da-dum dum deedle deedle dum deedle dum dum deedle deedle dum. At Festival Sabalad we have a lot of activities. We start with and we raise the flag in the park that knows our sad. We have a steeple race and what we call the Tatamon, which means, hey, let's all make noise, that's what this event is for. Da-dum dum deedle deedle dum deedle dum dum deedle deedle dum. We have a gala dance, a Sunday morning mass, and a brunch at the genealogy shop where you can learn a lot about our families here before. We have a glimmer of pride in our eyes as we share our history. We love to tell about our past and how it came to be. Da-dum dum deedle deedle dum deedle dum dum deedle deedle dum. In the winter time when nights are long, we all gather at Jude's on Sunday afternoon for a great meal with our peers. Well, once the meal is over, we look forward to a night of fun. We all sing a song as the night goes on, like you did when it first begun. Well, vive les Acadiens de Torbay, car ils sont chereux. Le grand capitaine basque, ravagé par le roi de France pour pâcher l'océan immense. Oui, ça valait, ça valait. Le grand capitaine basque, ravagé par le roi de France pour pâcher l'océan immense. voyager par le roi de France pour pêcher l'océan immense.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mary Janet McDonald, and I live in Port Hood, Inverness County, Cape Breton Island, Nova Scotia. And since the pandemic began back in March, I have started a baking show every Sunday just to pass the time. And I make most of the time just traditional recipes that have been passed on to me or Cape Breton flavored recipes. And I bake with everybody on my Facebook page called Tunes and Wooden Spoons every Sunday at 2 o'clock. And it's been a joy and it's been a help to me and it's been a help to many of the viewers. So I'm just gonna keep on going. And that brings me to me today. I am so happy to be here and bring you greetings for a happy holiday season. And I hope you have a wonderful few weeks ahead preparing and celebrating with your family in your bubble, whatever that may be. Today, I wanted to share with you one particular Cape Breton recipe that certainly brought a lot of joy to many of the viewers, and it was something that I didn't really know myself. Perhaps you've heard of pork pies. The name would convey that it held meat, and in fact, it absolutely doesn't. And one of the interesting facts I found out is that pork pies are a Cape Breton thing, and the research has proven that back to 1930, it was found in a Cape Breton recipe book. And a few years ago, the Cape Breton Post had a contest whereby they put a number of Cape Breton celebrated dishes, things that were traditional to the Scottish diet most of all, I think, like oat cakes and blood pudding and fish cakes and pork pies and bologna. There was many things. And the readers voted and pork pies came out on the top. And who knew? I had no idea that it was a Cape Breton thing because I've seen them around for years, especially at Christmas time. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with pork pies, it's made in a mini muffin tin and or a tartlet pan, which I call it. And it has a shortbread base, very buttery, wonderful base in it. And then it's got a date filling, and it's got, has to have maple frosting. And I'll just show you what they look like. So maybe you might recognize them, but I made these on my show last Sunday and people were just so happy because many Cape Bretoners are away from home and just loving that I was doing pork pies because something that their moms and grandmas had made years ago and they never did get the recipe. So I'm going to give you a quick wrap up off the recipe. The shell itself at the bottom, it's got 1 cup of butter, has to be butter, and 2 cups of flour and 2 tablespoons of icing sugar, and that's it. And you mix them with your hands. That's the best spoon that there is from way back when. You mix that up into a nice dough and you roll it out and you cut it, or you don't, you put it in little balls and you put it in the mini muffin tins. And with your thumb, you make it reach up to the top and have a dip in the center. You bake them for, I think it's 12 minutes in a 350 oven, and then you cool them. And meanwhile, you make the date filling, which is 2 1/4 cups of pitted dates chopped, 1 cup of water, 3/4 cup of brown sugar, 1 teaspoon of vanilla, and 1/4 teaspoon of salt. You put that all in a medium-sized pot and you stir that maybe 4 or 5 minutes until it's soft. And then you kind of mash it up and then you put it to cool somewhere. And then when the tart shells are cool, you fill them with about 1 teaspoon of the date filling. Then you make the frosting, which is 1/4 cup of soft butter, 1 teaspoon of maple flavoring, and it's hard to get. So if you don't have maple flavoring where you live, you can always use some maple syrup, and 2 1/4 cups of icing sugar and 3 1/2 tablespoons of milk. And you beat that up with an electric beater. And I like to use just one of those little plunger style cake decorators and make with a little star tip and just put a little plunge of that on every one. And that is the recipe. And I hope that maybe you'll get a chance to make them. And to close off, I just want to wish you all happy holidays. Stay healthy. follow the protocols, enjoy each other's company in your bubble, and have a wonderful time in these coming weeks and when family gather in your little bubble. And it was wonderful to be with you. So take care and love to all. Bye-bye.
Joy in the children's eyes, the way that the old folks smile, says the Christmas. folks smile. Santa Christmas will never go away. This year of Christmas will never go away.
When I was 9 years old, I used to listen to the Judy Flyer whistle blow, and I always wondered where it went. So, in 63 or 61, I was cutting Christmas trees with my father up at the Yellow Brook, and we had the old truck. We loaded the Christmas trees onto the truck, and I wonder where this Christmas tree will go. So I wrote a letter, and I put it in plastic bags, and I tied the letter to the Christmas tree. I tied it really tight so that no one would see it. Put it close to the trunk, and I went down to the Judick station with my father, and we got 50 cents for the tree that I tied the letter to. Anyway, I watched them load the tree onto the train. It was freight. So then I came home, and I waited, and I waited. Then one day in February, there was a parcel at the post office in Judick for me. I was 9 years old. You didn't get much mail then. So we got in the truck and we went to the station, or down to the post office. And at the post office, they had the package. It was a big package, and it had Rita Poirier written on it. I was so proud. I took it home and we opened it. It was from Pennsylvania. And it was a family, their name was Carvers. They had received the tree and put it up on Christmas night and found the letter. They had paid $50 for the tree. I had gotten 50 cents for the tree. But they sent me beautiful gifts, a train set for my brother, and a lovely chocolate alligator for me, and other gifts so precious. So then I knew where the Judith flyer went every time the whistle blew, and it made the best Christmas gift.
We have been fans for a long time of one of Canada's finest songwriters, Bruce Cockburn, and this is the first vocal song that he has on his Christmas album. That album came out in 1993, but the song dates back to 1929. We love it, and we hope you enjoy it too. It's called Early on One Christmas Morn.
Richmond County from Magdalene.
And Ray, hi.
Hi, and you might see Wilbur in a minute.
Here's
and Wilbur. Okay, we are two of the Baha'is from Ile Madame, and we have a song for you this morning from the beloved character Abdul Baha of our Baha'i faith, and it has three lines. One.
Where there is love.
Two.
Nothing is too much trouble.
And three.
And there's always time.
So we're going to sing it for you now so that you have the melody. Where there is love, where there is love, nothing is too much trouble, nothing is too much trouble. Where there is love, where there is love, nothing is too much trouble, nothing is too much trouble. And there's always time, 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 and there's always time. Time, time, and there's always time. We love you, Richmond County. We love you, everybody. Happy holidays.
Bye.
Bye.
Merry Christmas, everybody down in Richmond County and surrounding areas from Fort McMurray, Alberta. A lot of us would probably be down there this time of year, traveling back home to spend Christmas with our families. And this year, we're not really doing that. With this pandemic and things, social distancing, staying put, that sort of thing, we can't travel. So now we're doing Christmas different. We're spending it sort of using technology to kind of get together and do things a little differently. Still have a good time, but just do it in a safe way. So everybody enjoy your holidays, and I'm going to say hi to my mom over the Facebook, over the FaceTime. Wish her, well, a happy Thursday because we talk every day. But yeah, we use technology a lot. She's 86 and she has learned quite a bit. So enjoy your Christmas, everybody. This is a little bit of Christmas here in Fort McMurray, and we'll be calling on Mother. Hi, Mama, you're sideways, but that's okay.
You're sideways.
Oh. Oh, yeah, now you're normal. Hi, Mama. So Merry Christmas, everybody. Hi. In Richmond County. This is how I say hi to my mom. We use FaceTime and technology because we can't be together over the holidays.
So. Hi, Mama.
Hi, Mama.
Hi.
Merry Christmas.
Hi. He's our cameraman. It's Cohen.
Joyeux Noël.
It's Cohen. Joyeux Noël à toi aussi.
Merci.
Merci. Merci from Cohen. Merry Christmas from Fort McMurray, Alberta, to all our friends and family back in Richmond County. Thank you. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Christmas to everybody in Richmond County and Inverness County and wherever you are watching this. A lot of family members couldn't be home this year. I'm one of them too. Hi, I'm Ashley McIsaac, and I'm missing being with my family in Port Hawkesbury. I'm hoping that you are all having a safe and COVID-free Christmas. If I was down there, I'm sure I'd be getting a beautiful meat pie from Sheddy Camp. Now, of course, there's always a big discussion of whether or not the meat pies are better down in River Bourgeois or in Sheddy Camp. And don't tell them I said this, but I like the ones in River Bourgeois. Anyway, I'm very happy. I love them in Sheddy Camp, don't get me wrong. But I'm a big fan of rabbit, so. Le lapin, Anyway, I want to wish us all again, as I say, a very Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah and all the different holiday seasons that you might be celebrating. And I'll play as a little bit of a tune, just something to hopefully let you know for when the next time I'm back down, maybe I'll stop over in Tell Ill or somewhere and play a tune for you there. All the best.
Season, everyone. We're going to discuss the Jewish holiday of Hanukkah, and we're going to divide it into three segments. And the first segment is the historical perspective. Back in the second century BC, the land of Israel was owned or governed by a Syrian Greek monarchy. Which at first was very benevolent, but by the middle of the century, a new ruler took over, and that's when the civil strife began, because he decided that the Jews were not going to be able to worship their own God anymore in the temple, and they were going to have to worship the Greek gods. A civil unrest and a civil war ensued. And the Jews, led by Judah Hamakabi, or Judah the Hammer, took control of the city of Jerusalem and the temple, and decided that, you know, and restored the temple, and that's what, and rededicated it. And that's what the word Hanukkah means, dedication. The temple was rededicated because during the course of the civil war and the civil strife, it was desecrated by the authorities, And when the Jews took it over again under the Judah Maccabee, they had to clean it and restore it and bring it back to the original state.
This brings us to the miracle of Hanukkah, which was finding a small cruse of oil left over in the desecrated temple. And when they lit the menorah, it lasted for not one day, but 8 days. And this is what brings us to the menorah here, the Chanukiah. I'd just like to explain the menorah, the Chanukiah. The higher candle is called the Shamash, it's the helper, and it lights all the others. On the first night, we light one candle, the second and the first, and third, 3, 2, 1, and we do it until it's 8 nights, and you light the candles from left to right, and you display it in a window for all to see. Hanukkah also has its own foods. We eat potato pancakes, which are called latkes, and you dip them in applesauce, sour cream, anything else?
Sufganiyot.
And no, I'm wondering about the dipping. Any other sauce, I guess, that you would like. And there are jam-filled donuts called sufganiyot that are very popular. There are games that we play with a four-sided dreidel. And
that's a spinning top.
And each side has a letter, Nun Gimel Shin He, which stands for Nes Gadol Hayasham, a great miracle happened there. And you spin it, and whatever letter it falls on means if you win or you have to give up half of your nuts or coins. And it's just a fun little game that we play. We used to get, instead of exchanging gifts, when I was younger, we would get Chanukah gelt, which means money. And sometimes it was in the form of large sums or small sums, but probably small sums. And we would get chocolate coins, which were delicious to eat. One thing I do have to say is when we introduced it, or my son and his wife introduced it to their children, our grandchildren, it was wonderful to see them for the first Chanukah. When they lit the candles, they thought it was a birthday. And after they were lit, they blew them out, or they tried to blow them out. And it was really funny and amusing. And they were told that these candles are not birthday candles and you never blow them out. They have to extinguish themselves, you know, according to time. And that's it.
Well, the holiday of Hanukkah, because it's celebrated around in the month of December usually, and sometimes very close to Christmas, has morphed into a enormous commercial enterprise. And the children, when I was a child, if I got a dollar or two from my grandfather or my parents, it was a big haul. Now the kids get a present every night. Or it's been used as a vehicle to make a donation. When the kids have everything, it's used to make a donation to a charity, so the kids learn that it's important to do that sort of thing. But I just want to recall one story which goes to show that children don't know the difference between religions. It's the ability of a child just to be interested in the presents and the gifts. When my eldest grandson was going to celebrate his second or third Hanukkah, and he knew what it was a little bit, we told him that Hanukkah was coming and that the Jewish people celebrate Hanukkah. And he said he wasn't celebrating because he was Jewless. And then when we told him you get presents every night, he says, okay, I'll be Jewish, you see. So for children, it's all the same thing. They don't know about the differences in religion. It's a happy time. And it's a family time, much as it is in all other religions. And with that, we'll wish you a happy holiday season and a healthy one, and enjoy yourselves.
Just putting some lights on the Christmas tree outside this year. You know, like everyone else this year, I kind of felt like not celebrating Christmas because we really can't go anywhere or be with anyone. But then Port Hawkesbury's favorite entertainment son, Adam Cook, asked me if I would do a little video to share with some of the seniors in this area. And then I got to thinking, how selfish not to put up lights, and how selfish not to celebrate Christmas. And I got to thinking about many of the Christmases that I've spent with my family and my friends and my loved ones. You know, memories of my daughter and my grandchildren, who taught me to be brave, and my father, who taught me that no matter what the circumstance, laughter is the best medicine. So without ado, I'd like to share with you a story by Newfoundland's favorite buddy, what's his name? Wayne Chalk, performed with the other fellas. And I hope if they happen to get to see this, I hope they'll forgive me for changing it up a little bit. And hey, they did give me permission to recite some of their works. So I give to you the catfish story. When I was a girl of very few years, I heard my father say, "Cats, they'll cause you trouble, girl. Sure, they're better put away." But I neglected his advice, and I got one a year ago. And last Saturday night, his words came back, so plain as the driven snow. You see, the time was up for a party, and I got some wine and beer. And I got myself a 10-pound salmon, and I called friends far and near. But preparations were hampered when I discovered, to my chagrin, the cursed cat had chewed away half of the salmon skin. Well, I fed the cat to the snowbank, and I pondered on its crime. And I went to work, since the party horde would arrive in a very short time. After doctoring the lovely fish, I was convinced that none could tell. The secret, I would keep it to myself, till all hands had their fill. Now there was Joe from the cove, and Bill from the hill, and fabulous Miss Martin, too. And George came down from the barracks hill on his 20-year-old skidoo, and my, they danced, laughed, drank, and they ate, till the night was properly spent. And then in various shades of merriment, to their homes they went. But now I was left with a mighty mess, and I started to tidy away. But as I passed along by the window, I noticed an object in the driveway. I opened the door for a closer look, and there, stretched still and cold, lay the old black cat, with no more life than Georgie's clothesline pole. Well, I tried to continue, but to no avail, for fearful thoughts occurred. Suppose it was the salmon that killed the cat. Food poisoning, that was the word. Well, panic struck, unfocused eyes scanned the telephone book. The number for the doctor as the pages shivered and shook. Her advice to me was definite. Everyone should be contacted, and they should go to the local hospital and their stomach contents extracted. Well, 30 phone calls later, all hands were informed, and as they dragged themselves to the hospital, new cursing words were born. I dare say it was 6 o'clock in the morning before the strange ordeal was through, and I was strolling out my driveway when out came George Carew. He looked at me with eyes so sad and words near knocked me flat. Last night, when I drove home, old girl, I ran over your old black cat. And there you have it. So without further ado, I'm going to light up this Christmas tree. Try and light up this Christmas tree. Here we go. I wish you all a very Merry Christmas, a safe and happy New Year, and hopefully next year we can all be together in person again. Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merci beaucoup.
I'm at a party I don't wanna be at, and I don't ever wear a suit and tie. I'm wondering if I can sneak out the back. Nobody's even looking me in my eyes. Can you take my hand, finish my drink, say, shall we dance? Hell yeah. You know I love you, did I ever tell you? You make it better like that. Don't think I fit in at this party. Everyone's got so much to say. Yeah, I always feel like I'm nobody. Who wants to fit in?
I was born and raised in Germany. I lived in the French Cove area for 20 years now. And I just want to let you know how, for me, Christmas was in Germany. So when I was a kid, Christmas usually started for us actually last night, which was December the 5th. That was the time when St. Nicholas came around. And that was actually the guy in the red suit. And he didn't come through the chimney, he just pretty much walked by the house. And we usually just left a boot, a rubber boot or a winter boot, outside the door. And he dropped some candies, nuts, oranges, and a little gift. So it was sometimes just like this, or like I said, in a boot. And that was kind of like the start of Christmas for us. And the main part of Christmas was for us December the 24th, so Christmas Eve actually. So usually we didn't have a Christmas tree up before that day. My parents, they put the tree in the house without me knowing, and they decorated the tree behind closed doors. Then we had a little family gathering, like grandma and grandpa. We had a light dinner, and all of a sudden you could hear in the living room a little bell, and that was the sign that the Christmas angel actually came through the window and dropped all the gifts. So Christmas Eve was actually the main part of Christmas, not Christmas Day. So then we went in, we kind of, you know, unwrapped all the gifts and had a good time. And yeah, that was pretty much the main part. And on December the 25th and the 26th, that was just kind of like days for family gathering, meals, good times. It varies sometimes from region to region a little bit, and from family to family. So for us, we always had kind of like a light dinner on Christmas Eve, nothing fancy. And then we had kind of like a turkey, or what was very common too, a goose. Or in some families, what we never did because we never liked it, some families even had fish. And that was usually a specific fish. I don't know the English word for that actually, but it was kind of like it was a freshwater fish, and it was kind of like a big fish. And they cooked the whole thing in a pot, and it came on the table, and everybody had a feast from that fish. So it varied a little bit. And yeah, that was pretty much the Christmas when I was a kid back in Germany. And what we say in Germany for Merry Christmas is Frohe Weihnachten. Thank you.
Thank you. Tretina, and this is my husband Joe Tretina, and we live in Port Hawkesbury. We were asked to contribute some information and thoughts about the Baha'i faith for this video. Some of you know Baha'is, and for others it is a new word, and it refers to those who recognize Baha'u'llah, who is a prophet founder of the Baha'i faith.
Baha'is live in all the countries of the world and come from many different backgrounds. We're drawn to the vision that Baha'u'llah brought over 150 years ago, that humanity is one, and that humanity's great religions are inspired by one creator. Baha'u'llah explained that God guides mankind through the ages and that he sends prophets referred to as messengers of God to guide us. Baha'is recognize and have a great love for all these divine messengers, such as Moses, Buddha, Christ, and Muhammad. We also recognize the profound spiritual truths found in the teachings of great indigenous teachers of the past. These teachers from God have all taught us to love God and love one another. Baha'is believe that we will move towards unity and we will soothe the diverse peoples of the world as belonging to one human family, and will learn to live together in a spirit of friendliness and fellowship.
Christmas, the celebration of the birth of Christ, is a beautiful time when millions of people show their love of God through their efforts of compassion and caring for all. Baha'is also celebrate the birth of their founder. The forerunner of the Baha'i faith is known as the Bab, and that means the gate, and he prepared the way for Baha'u'llah. Each year, the birth of the Bab and the birth of Baha'u'llah are observed as twin holy days, since they occurred within one day of each other. It is a very special time. The celebrations are joyful and include neighbors, family, friends from all faiths and backgrounds. with the goal to promote understanding and unity among all. And Baha'is also enjoy very much taking part in the activities of other faiths and diverse cultures.
Baha'is have frequent gatherings to share prayer, scripture, music, and meaningful texts and discussions with all who would like to attend. Everyone's welcome. It's been an honor to be part of this DVD. If you want to know more about the Baha'i faith, you can find good information on the internet at baha'i.org.
We sincerely hope that you are able to find peace and happiness during this time, no matter what your beliefs are, and to be assured that we are with you in spirit. May you all enjoy the warmth and love of each other and stay safe.
And this is Alfred LeBlanc. I love my rooster.
My rooster loves me. I cherish my rooster. Eat the green day tree. My little rooster goes caw. Diddy doo, diddy doo, diddy doo, diddy doo, diddy doo. hen, my hen loves me. I cherish my hen, eat the green bay tree. My little hen goes, ah! My little rooster goes, I love my cat and my cat loves me. I cherish my cat, neath the green bay tree. My little cat goes, meow. My little hen goes, ah! My little rooster goes, cock. Ready do dee doo dee dee doo dee dee doo dee dee doo. I love my dog and my dog loves me. I cherish my dog, neath the green bay tree. My little dog goes, whoop, whoop. My little cat goes, meow. My little hen goes, ah. My little rooster goes, cock. Ready do dee doo dee dee doo dee dee doo dee dee doo. Bang, 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 bang. I love my cow and my cow loves me. I cherish my cow neath the green bay tree. My little cow goes, whoop.
My little dog goes, whoop, whoop. My little cat, ah.
My little rooster goes cock-a-doodle-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo. I love my horse and my horse loves me. I cherish my horse neath the green bay tree. My little horse goes,
my little cow goes, my little dog, my little cat goes,
my little rooster goes cock-a-doodle-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo-dee-dee-doo. I love my wife and my wife loves me. I cherish my wife neath the green bay tree. My little wife goes
cock-a-doodle-dee-doo. My little horse goes,
yeah.
My little cow goes, my little dog goes, woof, woof. My little cat goes,
meow.
My little
rooster goes cock. Ready do dee do dee dee do dee dee do dee 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 bonjour. Aux montagnes. Et que la nuit rencontre le jour. Je suis seul avec elle sur la montagne. Une voix me rappelle de toi. J'écoute à ma porte la chanson du vent qui me rappelle des souvenirs de toi. Quand le soleil dit bonjour aux montagnes, je suis seul et je puis penser qu'à toi. Now when the sun says good day to the mountain and the night says hello to the dawn, I'm alone with my dream. On the hilltop, I can still hear her moan, though she's gone. I hear from my door the love song through the wind. It brings back sweet memories of you. Now when the sun says good day to the mountain, je suis seul et je ne pense qu'à toi. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give ye to what we say. News, news, Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. Good Christian men rejoice.
He has opened heaven's door, and man is blessed forevermore. Christ was born for this, Christ was born for this. Good Christian men, rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye need not fear the grave. Peace, peace, Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you one and calls you all to gain his everlasting hall. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save.
Bye. trying to speak, but I can't find my words. They snatched it away, shattered my world. And say that I can't wait to mend yours. Free me so my spirit can soar. As a warrior, I'm stronger.
Shadows we dance in the dark.
was a cold February morning at 3 a.m. and I was sound asleep in my bed, cozy, when my mother woke me out of a deep sleep. And she said, "Take a sigh. Take a sigh." "Now," she said, "come in. Come in here. Come downstairs and look. See, do you see what I'm seeing?" I put my feet on the cold floor and hesitated. I thought, what does she want at 3 a.m. in the morning? I went downstairs. She said, "Look out the kitchen window." And I looked out at St. George's Bay in the Northumberland Strait. The big ice was in. It was February. My God, yuck and hey. That was a ship, a burning ship. She said, "Do you see what I see?" I said, "Yes." She said, "Take the binoculars." I took the binoculars, and there you could see the men and the masts were burning. And it was a tall old ship from long ago. My mother said, "You know, they're called the White Sails of Judic. That's a phantom ship. It's a forerunner that someone will drown at sea within the next so many months." She said, "You're sure you see it too?" "Yes." That's the only time I ever seen the burning ship, although I've talked to people that have seen it. And the White Sails of Judic are known all over for being seen. It was the old fleet that used to come out of Judic. And now the phantom ship still flies before there's a disaster at sea. Anyway, that's what I know. It's called second sight in the old Scottish way.
Christmas, the celebration of the birth of Christ, is a beautiful time when millions show their love of God through helping each other. Often at Christmas, many people make efforts to show their compassion for all who may need some extra help. Baha'is too celebrate the birth of the founders of their faith. It is a special time when we have the twin birthdays of the Bab and Baha'u'llah. The Bab foretold the coming of Baha'u'llah. Celebrated together since their births occurred within a day of each other, the celebrations are joyful and include family, friends, and neighbors from all faiths and backgrounds. Baha'is are also guided to be generous and charitable on the holy days. They also enjoy taking part in the activities of the special days of other cultures and faiths. It is common that their spouses can come from different religious backgrounds.
There are several special days that Baha'is celebrate. In February, there is a period of 4 or 5 days called Ayyamiha. And throughout these days, all are encouraged to provide good cheer for themselves, their kindred, and beyond them, the poor and the needy. Often this means parties for children, their friends, and for their neighborhood. Youth and adults may take on projects to improve their town. Small gifts, sometimes made by hand, are exchanged. This is a festive time.
There are regular activities in the Baha'i community, such as children's classes for children, programs for 11 to 15 year olds, and study circles for teens and adults. These activities are open to all.
Thank you for watching this brief introduction to the Baha'i faith.
I'm gonna do it, put him in, I'm gonna do it, put him in, I'm gonna do it, put him in, check the crystal accounts, moving.